Welcome to the A-Game Podcast with Nick LaMagna, digging into the minds and experiences of some of today's brightest entrepreneurs in real estate and business, along with Hollywood stars, UFC fighters, and your favorite rock bands. People that have figured out how to overcome obstacles, take chances, live boldly, and no matter what they do, they always bring their A-game.
My mission with the A-Game Podcast is to have successful people who have overcome obstacles and self-doubt to achieve amazing things in life and show you that ordinary people achieve extraordinary things every single day, personally, physically, mentally, and of course, financially. And every single one listening to this podcast are going to be able to learn from our guest to see how you can take your situation and achieve financial freedom and achieve all the hopes and dreams you guys have wanted. And you will learn that through the various episodes of this podcast as you keep listening. So thank you so much for coming along this journey. My guest today on the A-Game Podcast is the Henry Washington. He is the co-host of the On The Market Podcast by BRRRR with James Daynard and Kathy Fecky. He has a fantastic social media where you can see all the links on the notes for the show, where he drops tons of good content. He also has his own mastermind called See You at the Closing Table. And he's also got a new book coming out that we're going to put links in for that drops this week. So follow us on social media, play along, tag along with all the stuff we have going on social media. We're going to do a giveaway for his book. So I'm going to give away 10 free copies of his brand new book published by BRRRR. But if you do not know who Henry Washington is, you have been living under a rock. This guy has been taken over in just around 5 years. He's acquired over 100 doors, single family, multifamily, mobile home parks, seller finance deals, creative deals, private money, rehabs, wholetails, wholesales, so many different things. He's a staple of the BRRRR community. You'll see him on many stages sharing some of the biggest stages in real estate with some of the biggest names in real estate. Everybody loves Henry Washington. So he's a guy investing out of Arkansas, great social media, great content, and he's a giving person where his whole philosophy, as I've said many times, is this is a business about money, but it's really about people and relationships. And he has become a master of putting people first and getting a reputation for building relationships and helping people. And because of that, he has also made a lot of money. So to me, what more could you want than having more money, a better quality of life, and helping people along the way? And he is helping others do the same now and teaching. You guys had to jump in with his coaching program at the Closing Table. And I will put all the links in there to see him at the Closing Table in the show notes for the show. So definitely check it out to order the book, to follow the podcast, to join him if you would like to be part of his mastermind and his coaching program. And of course, just connect on social media. That's what this whole thing is about. It's connecting as people. It's sharing the journey. And of course, all the show notes will be at nicknicknick.com/links, L-I-N-K-S. And while you're there, you can see all the ways to subscribe to this podcast. So even though I got a scratchy voice today, please remember the whole reason we're able to do this is we get great guests like Henry to come on because he sees that he's bringing you guys value and then tells other people that he made an impact on our community. So the only fee for this show to keep getting amazing guests like Henry to come on and give you great information is to subscribe to the podcast. So take a minute on any of the places you listen to your podcast. You will see all the links on nicknicknick.com/links, and you'll also see all the ways to connect on social media. So please connect with us on social media. Please interact with the post. So everybody's scrolling on social media all day anyway. While you're there and you see me dropping some great clips from the content Henry gave us this episode, share it, like it, repost it. I cannot tell you enough how far that goes for the algorithm. So please remember to like, share, or comment on it. For your sake, for my sake, for Henry's sake, and for the sake of keeping this podcast going for another 300 episodes, thank you so much. And again, the big thing here is I want to do real estate together. So either text me or DM me the words real estate on any of my social media, or text me the words real estate to 516-540-5733. Again, that is 516-540-5733. And we could talk about if you want to buy a property from me, if you want to sell a property to me, or if you would just like to figure out how we can have a conversation to see how we can partner together or collaborate on some level. And while you're there, if you would like a free checklist to bring more money to your buyers as a real estate broker or seller, go to nicknicknick.com/biggerpockets. I have been trying to get Henry on for a very long time. I always see him at these events. We're in a couple of masterminds together. And the guy's always just a good guy, bringing tons of value. always dropping the heat and always just being a kind soul. So I appreciate you so much, sir. Thank you for coming on and sharing your story, sharing your wisdom. I think you guys are going to love this episode. We talk about so many different aspects of the mindset and the decision-making process, the deals he takes down, how he funds them, what he does, how he finds them, and a lot of the back and forth, whether it's your first deal or your 100th deal, everybody's going to have something they can take away from this fantastic episode. So thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Henry Washington. Thank you, Bigger Pockets. And thank you, A-Game Podcast, ladies and gentlemen. Have a great day. All right, my guest today came from the IT world as a software developer and data analytics specialist, spending the money he made when he had a panic attack, which acted as a catalyst triggering the need for a drastic change in his financial future. And of course, he found real estate investing. Now fighting out of Northwest Arkansas, he is a business owner, entrepreneur, and full-time real estate investor, owning over 100 units and doing around a dozen or so flips a year. He has a massive tool belt of real estate strategies that he has paired with amazing people skills to build himself a brand to feed his family for a lifetime. He is an outside-the-box investor using small banks and private money as well as seller financing to build a portfolio, build a track record, and has formed a fantastic reputation in this industry. Everywhere you go, people love him. You can find him as a staple in the Bigger Podcast community, including being the co-host of the On The Market podcast with fellow friends and guests, Kathy Fecky and James Daynard. And he is now about to release his first book published by the world-famous Bigger Pockets, which we will dig deeper into. He also helps real estate investors find success in his real estate mind called The Closing Table. He has a mastermind, which he helps other people achieve financial freedom through real estate as well. His social media is content rich. And of course, we're going to dig deeper into his book. He is a father, a husband, an educator. He looks more and more jacked every time I see him. Please welcome to the A-Game Podcast, the king of The Closing Table, Mr. Henry Washington.
What's up, buddy? I think that was the best intro I think I've ever had in a podcast. That was amazing.
Thank you. Awesome, man. Well, you have a lot of highlights. It was hard to narrow them down into 1 minute. I know people get bashful if I go too long, man. But is there anything I left out that you want to bring up about your background for people who might be living under a rock and don't know who the Henry Washington is?
Oh, no, man. I think you nailed it, man. Just just a dude like everybody else who found themselves in a situation where he needed to figure out how to make more money and ended up down this weird path called real estate and changed everything for me.
So I think that that alone is such a huge piece, because when I talk to new investors, like I'm sure you do, they think they just need a calculator, they just need a spreadsheet, and they don't realize that it's not all about that. It's all these other things. It's making decisions, it's controlling fear, it's fighting the self-doubt. And I find you as a very interesting anomaly, because the fact that you come from a data analyst background, historically, those are not people that make quick decisions. And I think I heard you married your wife in like 1 year, like you actually do make decisions. And I feel like it doesn't match up with that side of your brain. So how do you become an analytical person who's actually really good at making quick decisions?
I don't know, man. I think I don't know that I was ever really like an analytical person at heart. I've always been a ready, fire, aim kind of guy. I've always been more emotional, for whatever right, wrong, or indifferent that is. The most analytical people who are very like matter of fact and you know, go by what's in front of them versus kind of how things make them feel. So I don't know, maybe I was just like playing the role of an analytics person, somebody with an analytical background, but just because I enjoyed technology, and that's kind of what led me down that path, is I enjoyed technology and figured it was a good way to make money sooner than later out of college. So just kind of stuck with that route. But so yeah, man, I've always just been I've always kind of had this mindset of, you know, we'll just jump off the cliff and figure it out on the way down.
That's awesome, man. I love that. And I think it's an interesting anomaly, because I don't know anybody who doesn't want to make more money and have a better quality of life. Like everybody does. Yeah. But, you know, I think most people, they have the panic attack when they start to do something new, and your fear and push kind of came for, I need to make a change. But then you actually did something with it. And I'm sure, as you're seeing with your coaching program, like people start things and the second they see that it gets hard, they quit. But you seem to have really made decisive decisions in your life to say, this is what I'm doing, and really not waffle or have the buyer's mortgage decision fatigue. So is that something that you've always had? And how do you work with people when you come across people that want to invest and they don't really have that ability?
Well, I would say that, you know, I do. I you know, not to disagree, but like I do waffle and I do get decision fatigue, and, you know, I do wonder why the heck I'm doing this, and I just choose to keep going anyway, is I think the difference between successful people I could, it's not just like successful real estate investors. It's really like that's the approach you need to have with anything that you're pursuing. I made the decision to figure out how to get good at real estate when I saw that most, like, there were just lots of regular people doing it. And so I figured if everybody else figured it out, I got to be able to figure it out. And I needed, at that point in my brain, like, I needed to figure something out sooner than later. And so I just made a decision at 3 a.m. to figure it out. And I didn't realize at that moment, like, how powerful that was. Like, I'm not saying I had all this wisdom to know I'm going to make a decision and stick to it. I just, that was what my life needed at the time. And so, but what I learned looking back is that there's a lot of power in making decisions. And I think once you learn that lesson, it's easier to continue to make tough decisions, because when you're making a decision, we're really putting our brain to work for us. And oftentimes, especially in business and entrepreneurship, like, we have to make decisions and then not know how we're going to do the thing we just decided to do. Right. And, but making the decision really helps our brain help us figure out the how, right? By turning your brain on to, like, you've told your brain, like, we're going to figure this out no matter what happens. And so your brain goes to work and starts looking for the solutions, right? And so every time you're around other people who are doing something similar, or you're, in an environment where things are happening that are in that niche, you start to hear things and your brain processes them different, and you'll start to realize, oh, that's the thing I should be doing. Oh, maybe I should try that thing, versus what most people do, versus what I do when I tell myself I'm going on a diet, right? I'll say, I'm going to try it, right? And trying a diet doesn't get you success, right? You have to make a decision that you're going to stick to the diet no matter what. It's the same thing with entrepreneurship. And so I think, that's just a really long-winded way of saying I was fortunate enough to make a decision, even when I didn't know how powerful that was. And I didn't know how to do it, but because I decided I was going to figure it out and be successful, like, it, what felt like doors just kept opening, right? It felt like, oh, there's an opportunity here. Oh, well, there's how I can find the money for this deal. Oh, well, here's who I can talk to about that thing. And it seems like, from the outside looking in, oftentimes we'll see successful people, or we'll see somebody where it looks like they just woke up one morning and found all the success. But what you don't know is what they did to position themselves to be able to take advantage of the opportunities when the doors opened, right? Because doors did open for me, but no more doors opened for me than opened for anybody else. The difference is I was mentally prepared to walk through them, even though I didn't know how, and I wasn't going to take no for an answer. And I think a lot of the times that's what people do. A door might open, and, like, for example, when I bought my first property, I didn't have good credit. I didn't have money to buy the property. And so when my buddy approached me and said, hey, I want to sell you my house, I'm going to sell it to you at a discount as long as you can close in 30 days. Most people, when that door opened, would have said, I don't have good credit and I don't have the money for the down payment. So, man, I'd help you, but I can't, right? That's what most people would have said. So we wouldn't have walked through that door. So the opportunity was there, but the decision helps position you to be able to take advantage, because I just said yes and started figuring it out along the way.
I think that's awesome, man. And when you talk about being able to go to people and ask them about different stuff, it's a pretty amazing world. Like, I've been doing this, it's like 16, 17 years now, and we didn't have social media and Zooms and masterminds like you run. Like, those things weren't as prevalent. Like, you might be able to get on a group call once a week. Like, it wasn't the same. And I still feel like there was a little bit, when I first started out, of people holding the secrets. It's like jiu-jitsu. 15 years ago when I started jiu-jitsu, you couldn't go train at other schools. And anything that they were teaching, they were like, you're not allowed to show this to anybody else. This is only our stuff. And now I can go anywhere in the country and make a phone call, and everybody's happy to share and then want to hear, like, what I have to offer. And I feel like with communities like Bigger Pockets, with, like, the masterminds you're in, it's a different world now where you don't really have to feel as scared and wonder, well, how do I raise money for the deal? You can literally see somebody on Instagram and go, hey, Henry just said he had a deal. He didn't have money. He had somebody else fund it. I'm going to DM him and see how he did it. And you'll be like, hey, man, like, here's the info. How much has that ability to be able to collaborate and be around the James Danards and the Kathy Feckys and the David Greens given you the confidence to keep going when you have that self-doubt?
Yeah, no, it's it means everything. And, you know, for people listening, like, you don't have to have, like, the network that I have. Like, I have an amazing network, but you don't have to have that. I think the point we're making here is just establishing some sort of network, right? Like, your proximity to other successful people shows you what's possible. And I don't think people are intentional enough about who they choose to surround themselves with when they're trying to take on a new endeavor like this, because man, it can really make a huge impact. I mean, it did for me when I had that first deal. I didn't know how to buy it. I knew I needed some money, didn't know where to get it. And so I was just able to go to my network of investors and ask them, how the heck are they finding money for these deals? And people literally just sat with me and tried to brainstorm with me all these ideas for how I could, you know, get my deal closed. But I think if you're new, like, being intentional about who you're surrounding yourself with is, like, almost, it's almost like a cheat code to being successful. Like, human nature really helps you in that situation. You know, I've told the story a bunch of times, but I interviewed a guy once who bought a, you know, it was like a 200 unit apartment building for his first deal. And when we asked him why he bought a 200 unit apartment building for his very first real estate deal, because most people buy a single and then they get a duplex and then they maybe get like a 4 or 5 unit, and then maybe they think about blowing it up from there. And he said, you know, all my friends bought apartment buildings. And so I just didn't know I wasn't supposed to do that. So that's just what I did. Right. And it was just, that's just how powerful proximity can be, because if that's what your network is doing, then they'll be able to assist you and you won't have any doubts as to whether it's doable because everybody around you is doing it.
Man, I think that's so great. I think I heard Ross Hamilton was saying, like, the biggest thing he gets from his network is he surrounds himself with people every day that teach him that things he thought were impossible are possible. And yes. I think that that's so powerful, man, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
So you came up with a dad who was an entrepreneur, though. So when you decided that you wanted to pull the trigger, and I know you worked your way out of your 9-to-5 and stuff, but did they support you because they had that background? Because I know a lot of people, when they first go and they say, you know what, I'm going to start getting into real estate investing, and then they tell their friends and family, most of them give them backlash. Yeah. Don't do that. Are you crazy to pay that money to learn from somebody? And then I always go back, well, what do they do? And they're going to people who don't invest in themselves, don't invest in real estate. Like, those are not the circles you're in. And so when I had trouble on deals and I turned around and tried to ask people, like, hey, contractor walked off my job, what should I do? They all go, well, I told you what to do. I told you to not do that in the first place. I told you so. But now, like, with the circles that are around me, every day I can call somebody who's on that same journey or has already been through it, and they're not going to beat you up. They're going to help you out. And so did you have that growing up, or did you have to find that?
No, I had to find it. My parents, you know, love me and support me for sure. But when I first got started, man, not even when I first got started, after I was, like, well into the business, I think it took them a while to realize that, like, I'm good now. Like, you know, my dad would often ask me, even after I, you know, had 30, 40 houses, he would ask me how my 401k is doing. Right. And I'm like, I got rid of that thing a long time ago. Right. Like my real estate's my retirement plan. And that's just, and there's nothing, like, there's no ill will or bad feeling about that. Like, they just didn't understand that. Like, he knows, you know, you go to school, get a good grades, you go to college, get a degree, go to work, climb a corporate ladder, like, that can offer you a fantastic living. And he sacrificed a lot so that I would have the opportunity to be able to do that. And so I don't frown on that at all. Like, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the sacrifices that he made. But once I started, and my mom, but once I started down the path of investing in real estate, like, they, you know, at some point I think they figured out that, like, oh, okay, he's got it now, and they're comfortable. But they never told me I was crazy for it. They just told me to be careful. They told me to be careful and to make sure that, you know, I make educated decisions with my finances and to, you know, just be smart about it. But they were never like, don't do that. You're going to, you know, go bankrupt. Yeah.
That's awesome, man. Now, I tell people all the time, as much as this is a business of money, I consider really a business of people and relationships. And I've heard many people compliment you as being such a great people person. And I can even say, like, when I saw you, I met you a couple of times at Bigger Pockets. I know you met a ton of people over there. But then we just met again recently at Family Mastermind and then at Paces. Yeah. But sometimes I'll see people there that I know. And you see people on social media enough that you feel like you know them and you forget that they don't, like, you don't know who the hell I am, but yeah. I see you every day. But you're very approachable. Like, you were somebody that I was like, I'm going to go say hi to him. He just seems like a nice guy to say hi to. Yeah. Did that come from your dad? Because I know your dad, I think, was restaurants
no.
and stuff. Like,
no, no, not at all. That came from my mom, my dad. If you saw my dad, you'd be the last person you'd want to approach cold out of nowhere. He's just, he's more introverted and tends to keep to himself. But once you kind of get to know him, then those walls come down. Like, he's a super likable person, but just from the outside looking in, like, he ain't the guy you would think to approach. It's all my mom had that, like, warm, approachable, loving personality who you just look at her and think, man, she probably will care about me. And so that's where I get that from, 100%. My sister's more like my dad, I'm more like my mom. My mom, she also always teased me. She'd say, man, you'll be fine. You'll make friends with a tree if you need to. And that's true. I've just always been an extrovert and a people person. And both my parents instilled in me the values of, my dad was really big on, respect and being respectful to everybody. And my mom was really big on just being kind. And so, I don't know, you put those two things together and I think I enjoy people. I tend to give everybody an A from start, whether I know you or not. You can work your way down from that grade, but it served me well. And don't get me wrong, it's burned me too. Just yesterday, I felt like I got burned for you know, doing something nice for somebody. But I think the lesson I was telling my wife and my team about it was that, like, if I had it to do again, I would have made the same decision. I'm not going to let somebody not understanding what I did for them or why I did it change whether I do that again. Like, kindness is kindness, and I'll continue to do that. And if I get burned doing that, man, that's okay. I'll just keep doing it.
Man, that is such great info. There's a very famous jiu-jitsu guy named Henzo Gracie. And he tells a story that I always basically close anytime I do, like, public speaking. I always end with it because he goes on this long talk he has about this lady that didn't want to talk to him. She worked in a toll booth and he kept trying to make her smile, make her laugh. And she was like, dude, give me my money and get the hell out of here. And he went back for weeks and he went back for months. And then they became friends. And then they had, like, dinners together. And, like, 20 years later, he was throwing her a surprise party. And then they said, dude, why did you keep going back? And he said, because either you change people or people change you. He said, either she was going to be somebody who stopped making me someone who likes to try and make people smile, or I was going to show her that people still want to see her smile. And I feel like that's kind of what you're saying, is at the end of the day, you know, when you open yourself like that to helping people, whether they appreciate it or not, you can't let those bad things taint the good in you.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And it's become the foundation of my approach to real estate investing. I have a very people forward approach to real estate investing, and that has been amazing because this is a people business. It transacts in real estate, but it's about the people. And the more I've learned to be of service to people, whether that financially benefits me or not, the more success I've had. And that, you know, it's just, it makes me feel good. I get to teach how to invest with a heart-driven, people focus to my students in my community. And when you were telling that story, I was just sitting here thinking, like, the coolest story I have from a win or a success story from one of my students has absolutely nothing to do with buying a property. And I love that. Like, I love that, you know, the goal for me and my community is we're going to make an impact by being of service to people. Sometimes that means we're going to buy houses and sometimes it doesn't, but that's okay. Like who we get to impact because of what we do is it's amazing. And it should, like, that's the way it should be. It shouldn't always be about the transaction.
Man, I think that that's such great words. I try and follow that myself. My buddy Jay always says, it's never about this deal. It's always about the next deal. And I'm
Yeah.
sure we both have countless stories where you do something, you don't get the deal, but then 4 or 5 months later, somebody calls you and they go, hey, so-and-so told me you treated them so good. And they said, I should call you. I need to sell my house. And it trickles down because you taught them good at the end
Yeah.
of the day.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That is 100%. Do you want me to tell the story real quick, or do you
Yeah, I
want
would love to
to
hear it.
run? Yeah, so one of my students, he sent me a message, or he posted in our community. He was doing some direct mail marketing, got a lead from a lady. She essentially called and said that just leave her alone and stop bothering her and don't send her any mail. And he was able to kind of work past that on the phone call and just could, I guess, hear or tell that, she just was lonely, wanted a friend. And so he was like, well, why don't we just meet and go to lunch and we can talk about real estate or we can talk about something else. And so he met up with her and they became friends, and he would meet up with her every couple of weeks or so and just take her to lunch, or and just talk to her about life or anything. And through those conversations, he learned that she didn't have a will in place or any plan for her property, and she was the only she had a daughter that she would want to pass some things off to. And so he was able to connect her with his attorney, and the attorney helped her kind of get an estate plan set up so that if in the event something happens to her, that the property wouldn't just be out there for some investor to grab, that it would stay within her family. And she unexpectedly ended up passing away, and that property went to her family now and isn't in limbo somewhere where, it's not, the wealth won't stay in her family. And that wouldn't have happened had he not reached out and tried to work through the apprehension that she had and developed this friendship and went out of his way to be of service to her, even though it had nothing to do with him buying that property. But now, she was able to take care of her family all through, something he learned from working through our community. And no one bought a real estate deal through that. And I still think that's super amazing.
If you have been kicking yourself that you didn't start investing in real estate sooner, whether you're beginner, intermediate, or advanced, any way you're looking to get in on residential, commercial, land development, wholesale, and fix and flips, whatever it is, let's find a way to get you involved in some projects, get you some properties, whether you want to sell some properties to me, whether you want to buy some properties from me, whether residential, fix and flip, cash flow, multifamily, whatever it is you're looking for, let's figure out a way to get you involved or find a way for us to partner up on some deals. Go to www.nicknicknick.com. Go on the consultation tab and figure out how to schedule an appointment to talk about where you fit in if you are not sure. Or you can just reach out to me on any of my social media channels. If you go on www.nicknicknick.com/links, you will see all the different ways to connect with me and figure out how we can start to work together, make it happen. Everybody that invests in real estate always just says they wish they did it sooner. Best time to start is today. That's awesome, dude. I love that. When you first brought it up, I felt like you didn't want to share it. So I was like, well, I'll let him bring it up. So I'm glad you did. That was awesome, man. People listening are going to kill me for bringing this up again, but have you ever read the book, The Five People You Meet in Heaven?
I have not.
Dude, it's such, I might be like a paraphrase of it. It's so cool because it's like and there's a movie too, if you want the cliff notes, but the movie was pretty good. But it's about this guy who, like, the premise of the movie is when you pass away, before you can cross over and go into heaven, there's this like holding pattern that you're in. And there's five people that are waiting for you that need to meet you before they pass on. And when the guy passes away, everybody expects it to be your mom, your dad, your kid, your dog, like whoever, like the closest people in your life. And it always turns out to be these people that they would have never guessed, that they were like, man, I met you once, like 42 years ago. Why are you here? And they always have these things like, man, you probably don't even remember this, but we were in a foxhole, or we were in an elevator, or you called me once on a phone call and I yelled at you, and then you helped me get my house into a trust. Like, there's all these little things that people don't realize. These little acts of kindness change somebody's life. And then years later, they go, you made such an impact on my life that you didn't even realize. And that's why I always try and go out of my way, when even when I don't feel like I have the time, if somebody stops to talk to me, I try and be like, maybe this is like nobody's listening to them and they need me to give them 5 or 10 minutes. And I'll find out when I pass away that changed their whole trajectory. So I kind of feel like that's what you're doing. And like, what bad could come of that, you know?
Right. Absolutely, man. Absolutely. We have to really remember that we're building wealth, but we're building wealth and there's another person's home on the end of those transactions. When you're dealing with, you know, single and small multifamily. And so, you know, it's easy to lose sight of that. It's easy to think about, oh man, I got to get a deal done, or I'm not going to be able to pay this bill or pay that bill or take care of my staff, or right. And we can get caught up being super transactional and forget that there's people on the other end of this that we need to take care of.
So this is an interesting topic now, because you being somebody who likes to give a lot of yourself, I'm a lot the same way. And I've had to learn that if you do too much of that, sometimes there's nothing left for you or for your family. Mm-hmm. And now if we're going back to people listening to this going, what the hell does this have to do with making money? I feel like it has everything to do with making money, because when you call up somebody, the people, when you're using distress and talk distress sellers, they're already emotional. Like, you can't now... they're already having a bad day. You can't be having a bad day too. And then both of you get on the phone, you just start bitching to each other. Nothing's going to happen. But I feel like when you learn how to kind of dial it back, de-escalate the situation, and come from a place of like, hey, I'm just here to listen, I'm just here to help. If you don't understand how that's going to make you more money, you're missing the whole point. But I guess my two-part question here is, the first one is, how do you find that fine line to draw that you're not giving too much of yourself away? So now you're not present either for your family, for yourself, for sellers, when they really need you to be in the moment and you can't because you have nothing left, or you're having your own bad day that you need to handle.
Yeah, man. You have to schedule some things that recharge your battery into your day. Right before this, I was at Top Golf hitting golf balls with a buddy of mine. I had a long day yesterday. I had a long week last week. I've got a really potentially tough meeting right after this. And so I said, you know what? I'm going to go get out in the sunshine with a friend of mine, and I'm going to whack the crap out of some golf balls and, you know, recharge the batteries so that I can, you know, approach, you know, refill my tank before I go into this tough meeting and, you know, before I bring any of that stuff home. So I just try to find time to schedule some things into my week that recharge my battery. And then it's tough to be able to like remember that, because it's easy to schedule over those things, but you have to remember they're as important as some of your business meetings, because if you don't recharge your battery, then it's the people around you who suffer. And that happens, man. It does. I got back from my trip when I was with you up in Phoenix. And I think that the day I got back, I said something that made my wife not happy with me. And the next day I said something that made my sister not happy with me. And I found myself having to apologize to both of them. And it was my sister who reminded me. She was like, hey, don't worry about it, but just take it as a sign that you probably need to refill your tank when you start, you know, lashing out at the people, you know, that love and care about you. And I was like, you know what? You're right. And so you just have to be intentional about scheduling some of those things. For me, I like to whack some golf balls and get out in the sunshine. Maybe just need to go for a walk. I follow a guy who said before he has tough conversations or goes into a meeting or has a conversation with somebody that he's upset about, he'll go on a walk. And oftentimes he finds out when he gets back from the walk, he's not really mad about the thing anymore. It just, you know, gives him time to think and reflect on it and get out in the sunshine and get some vitamin D. And you realize that it's really not that big of a deal. You just get caught up in your emotions sometimes.
Man, so quoting you, I heard you talking about anxiety and how a lot of the times, a lot of the energy and the stress you put on yourself over the years, when you actually face that, the situation was never as bad as it played out in your head. And as a business owner, you know, everybody sees, oh man, Henry Washington, he gets to speak on these stages, he gets to run these masterminds, he writes a book, he buys all these houses. And they think it's all rainbows and sunshine, but they forget. Like my buddy Matt Serra always says, like, we'll walk around, he'll go, they call me Knuckles. He's like, Knuckles, man, everybody wants to take a picture and the girls want to take a picture and the guys want to buy me drinks, but they forget, like, they want to be a UFC fighter. But every time you have to fight a guy in a cage in your underwear, they don't want to do that part. So I feel like everybody wants the amazing part that they see of your social media, but they forget that there's these things where you could be stressing out all day about this potentially tough conversation you have to have, and you build it up in your head and it steals all your energy and it affects everything around it. So how do you handle that anxiety or those voices in your head that build things up so you might want to put off tough conversations or tough decisions?
Boy, I don't know, man. And you tell, look, it reminds me of that, like, everybody wants to be a bodybuilder, but nobody wants to lift no heavy ass weights. Like, that's right. Like, it's, you know, I wish I was perfect at it. I'm not. I have days that I'm great at it. For me, I had to learn, and really it's marriage that kind of taught me this. It wasn't really business, but I've had to learn that, I am an emotional person and I can react emotionally, and I can, and when I do that, it's hurtful to the other party sometimes. And so I've had to learn that I have to give myself time to be emotional without involving somebody else. And so when things happen and I'm freaking out, I have realized, like, I got to give myself some grace to, like, be who I am. I get emotional about stuff. The problem with being emotional about stuff is when you make decisions and put things into play during that emotional period, or when you have conversations with people during that emotional period. And so what I try to do is, like, you know, if I'm having a pity party about something, like, I can set my timer and go be mad at the world about, you know, the woe is me's about whatever situation is. Like, I need to give myself the time to do that. And then I go, all right, well, so what are we going to do about it? It exists. That thing happened. So what are we going to do about it? Because just being pissy about it isn't solving the problem. But I have to give myself the grace period to be able to do that. Same thing with, you know, when somebody says something that angers me, like, I give myself the grace to be fussy about it, and I'll go in a room somewhere and fuss and curse them out, and then just won't do it when they're around. And then I'll say, okay, well, how do we move on from this point? Right. And then after I come down from my emotions, I typically find out 9 times out of 10 that it's something that I need to fix or change anyway about myself. And then we'll implement those things and we'll move forward. But I just have to give myself the grace to be able to be a human being sometimes and just not involve other people in that. And then it makes it easier to, once I've had that emotional outlet, it's like, all right, well, what are we going to do now? Let's go fix it.
Dude, you're so relatable. I guess this is why everybody says you're a people person. I feel like all the things you're saying, those are the things that I tell myself I'm going to do. And sometimes I just, like, I'm going to go in the other room myself.
I'm not batting 1,000 with this, by the way. Like, I'm just, this is what I want to do. And sometimes I do it well and sometimes I do not.
Fair enough, man. It's, you know, my buddy Truck, he was another guy. And I remember he won the Ultimate Fighter. And then his next fight we went to, and he got knocked out, like, real quick. And I thought he was going to be very emotional and mad after the fight. And he said something that I've applied to my life and my business, where he goes, you know what, man, I have a 72-hour rule. He goes, if I win the Ultimate Fighter, you know, I'm having a baby, I'm getting married, I close a really good deal, I got a big client, I'm going to give myself 72 hours to celebrate. I'll eat Big Macs, I'll go party, I'll screw off, I'll ignore my responsibilities for 72 hours. And then it's right back to business. He goes, or on the other side, I get knocked out, I lose a client, I'm having a fight with my girl, I get bad news, I'll give myself 72 hours to throw my pity party, to go just wallow in it and feels bad for myself, and then I go right back to business. He's like, but I never let it go more than 3 days or too high or too low. And I was like, man, that's like a really good happy medium for being able to be a human, but also, like, not let it get you too up or down so you can carry on and fight another day.
Yeah, absolutely. I've found that if I don't give myself, because we'll beat up ourselves, right? We're like, something bad will happen and we'll be like, man, the world sucks. Everybody hates me. And then you're like, no, that's not what it is. You know that. And then, but if you don't give yourself that time, you'll be like, no, F that. I do hate the, like, it's the, so you just have to, like, give yourself the grace period go have your moments, and then you'll figure out that, like, all right, I had my moment and then nothing's changed. So I have to go change something.
That's incredible, man. So pivoting now, once you get all that personal development and you get all that stuff taken care of, when you get your emotional intelligence, now we have the business side. So I know you have over 100 units. You've built up this whole portfolio with many different types of strategies. So talk a little bit about what your buy box is today.
Yeah, today, man, my business model hasn't changed much. Now, how we evaluate the deals and what we're willing to buy and where we're willing to buy them at, that changed. But my business model has always been to be relentlessly, consistently looking for deals, whether that's through some sort of paid marketing channel or some sort of marketing channel that takes a lot of time and effort. But you're going to spend either money or time and effort to find deals. And so I've always tried to model my acquisition side of my business around a wholesaler, because wholesalers are very, very good at marketing and finding deals. And so for me, it's about do everything we can to get really good at finding deals. And then as we find them, we try to monetize those deals in the way that makes the most sense for what's going on in my business at that time and our current financial situation. And so for me, that looks like I'm buying everything that's a deal. So I don't wholesale anything. I close on everything, and then the things that I like the most in terms of buy and hold, we'll keep. The things that I don't like the most, we're going to look at how do we flip those. And maybe it's by renovating it and flipping it. Maybe it's by not renovating it and flipping it. Or maybe it's by selling it directly to another investor after we own it. So that's pretty much, that's always how it's been. That's what we continue to do. Some years we'll do more renovation fix and flips. Some years we'll do more just wholesale sticking them back on the market. And some years, like this, the past two flips I did, no, not the last two. So probably of the last five deals I flipped, two of them, I just called another investor and said, hey, I just bought this house. Do you want to take a look at it and see if you want to buy it off me? So it's just whatever the best strategy is.
That's awesome, man. And I guess the two-part question here, one of them is, you know, I'm in the mindset right now of I don't have a lot of confidence in knowing where the market goes. And it's a little bit volatile. It could stay the same. It can go up. It can go down. But I don't feel good about like what's going to happen in 9, 12 months. So I don't personally like doing big flips right now. But if I was talking to Jay Daynard, he'd be like, dude, I just did a $2 million renovation in Seattle and I made a bunch of money on it. And you were very refreshing. I saw you do a presentation at the Bigger Pockets conference. I believe it was in Florida not that long ago. Mm-hmm. And you did one on wholetailing, but every single person at the Bigger Pockets conference was basically teaching a different strategy. And everybody was getting analysis paralysis of which one do I do? And I think somebody asked you that, man, and you had the best answer. You were like, you go next door, that person's going to say that PPC is the only way to make money, but it's because they focused on PPC. You go to that door, you're going to say rehabbing because all they do is rehab. I do direct mail, but I focus on direct mail. Whatever it's on is going to work for you. And I thought it was very realistic and very honest, but you're a guy who's surrounded by people doing all this different stuff. You're exposed to all these new shiny object stuff. How do you stay so structured to just work with the bread and butter and not go, I'm going to do what James does. I'm going to do what David does. I'm going to do what Pace does.
Oh, that is hard. That is hard. But the way I look at it and the way I tell my students to look at it is if you're picking your strategy, you need to know what your financial goals are, right? So first and foremost, you have to know, like, what's my financial goals? Am I looking to build up a bunch of cash flow so I can quit my job? Am I looking to build up a bunch of equity and appreciation over a long period of time? Am I looking to buy properties that I can use to offset my taxes? Like, whatever your financial goals are, establish what they are. Right. And then once you know what your financial goals are, pick the strategy, the real estate strategy that fits your financial goals. So it's going to help you hit your financial goals, A, but it also gives you, I call it the warm fuzzies, right? So you can call it whatever you want. It makes you feel passionate about something, like whatever gives you the warm fuzzies. Where those two things intersect, where you can do something that makes you feel good about what you're doing, and you can, and that thing is also going to help you hit your financial goals, then it becomes really easy to stay focused because you're passionate about what it is that you're doing. And so for me, that's single family and small multifamily real estate. It will help me hit my financial goals and it gives me the warm fuzzies. I invest in single family and small multifamily real estate, not because it's the most lucrative real estate strategy out there. It's not why I do it. I do it because it is the strategy that helps me help people. Like, it's very people focused. Because it's a lower risk strategy, I'm able to do things for people. Like, when I buy a house, if I need to let the seller live there for 3 or 6 months after I've paid them for the property, I have the flexibility to be able to do that because that's what they need. And I can offer them that opportunity. Yeah, it costs me a little bit of money every month in a mortgage payment, but it's such a low risk investment that I'm able to do that. I'm able to do things in terms of taking care of the people who are going to be able to buy the properties down the road. It's just, it allows me to be of service to people more. Whereas like large scale multifamily is different. That's about a P&L. That's about a business. You have to look at the numbers, decrease expenses, increase your profits, and you need to raise that P&L. Like, that is what you're doing in a large scale multifamily. And it's not really about the people that are living in those large scale multifamilies. And that just doesn't give me the warm fuzzies. I'm not saying that's bad. I'm not saying that it's not lucrative. It is extremely lucrative, but it just doesn't make me feel as good. And this business gets hard. And this business gets hard and makes you want to quit. And so if you're one of these people jumping strategies because you want to find the one that's going to make you the most money, when that strategy punches you in the teeth, like, are you going to stick it out? Because for me, I stick it out because I know I feel good about what I'm doing. I know I'm taking care of people. And so I'll just dust myself off, get back up, and continue living in my purpose. And so I think having those two things, it really helps me stay clear. Because then when opportunities come up that are outside of my, you know, thing that I'm doing, outside of that single and small multifamily, I can look at it through a lens of, okay, well, is this going to satisfy you from a financial aspect? Yes. Is it going to give you the warm fuzzies? No. Maybe I'll just stay where I'm at. And so when I do deals that are outside, because I have a mobile home. I have a mobile home park. I've got a commercial office building. I've done things outside of my niche. And so my rule for that is, if I'm going to do it outside of my niche, it has to be such a screaming deal that I can't say no to it, that I can't lose if I do it. And I can't say no to it, because then now I get paid to learn a new strategy. And then I can decide after I have that lesson if that's something I want to go more into. And so my mobile home park, I bought a 15 pad mobile home park. I paid $100,000 owner financed at 3%, right? Like, I couldn't not buy that deal, right? And now I get to learn about operating and owning a mobile home park and decide if I want to do more of that. My commercial office complex, we paid like $925 for it, but it's valued at like almost like 1.4. And so it was such a great deal. Plus my partners on the commercial office deal, like, only do commercial, like, that's their bread and butter. And so not only do I get to do a deal that is a great deal that it's hard to lose on, but I get to do it with somebody who's a specialist in that, and I get to learn. So I'm just careful about how I approach new strategies. And I use that lens to kind of help filter it.
Dude, that's awesome. I love that. That's really good info, really great answer. The last thing that I think parlays great into what you were talking about, being that you like to get the warm and fuzzies and deal with people, I feel like that's the same response I get when I talk to small local banks. They talk about, like, you know, the big banks, all they care about is the P&L, but we want to really learn about you. We want to learn about the deal. And I know there's some of your favorite ways to fund those deals. And I don't know if you still do this, but I think I heard at one point, did you say you were putting 50% cash down on the deals when you bought them as rentals?
No, I don't. I typically won't put anything down.
Maybe oh, good. Yeah, I definitely heard that wrong then, because I was like, I don't see it. No. Yeah, so talk about how you're using some of the small banks that'll fund your deals.
Yeah, man. The reason small local banks say that is because the way they make money. Don't get me wrong. Everybody's in this business to make money, right? Like, I do love people and I want to take care of people, but I have to make money too, right? Or else I'm going to go out of business, right? Same thing with small local banks. They want to work in a more people focused area, but that's because that's how they make money. Big banks make money by servicing loans and then selling the loans. Small banks make money by servicing loans and then keeping them in their portfolio and continuing to service them. They don't sell the loans off, which means they have to loan money to small local businesses in order to stay in business. And so if they don't operate on relationships, then they're not going to stay in business because they're lending to people within their local community. And so relationships are huge with small local banks. But from an investment standpoint, that's a huge advantage for you as a real estate investor, because you have a product that is lower risk for them, especially if you're operating in the single family and small multifamily space, because again, they're lower risk investments. And so if you think from a small local community bank, like put your small local community bank lender hat on, right? If you're a local community bank and you're a loan officer and your job is to go out there and find people to loan money to so that we can make money on the interest, and you go out and you're in the community looking for people to lend money to, and you come across Nick, and Nick is starting his food truck business, right? And he's gonna, Nick, what do you like to cook, Nick? What's your favorite dish to cook?
Man, I'm a terrible cook, but I'll DoorDash the crap out of anything.
So what's your favorite thing to eat?
I gotta say pizza. I'm a big pizza guy.
Right. You sound like a pizza guy. That makes sense. So Nick, so Nick's starting his little niche pizza truck, and he's going to make these amazing pizzas. And he's got this whole business plan about how he's going to make these phenomenal pizzas and everybody's going to love it. And so Nick needs to borrow, you know, $200,000 to start his food truck business so he can go buy his truck and all his food equipment. He needs a loan from a small community bank. And then the bank, community bank, also meets Henry, and Henry's got a real estate deal. Henry's going to buy a house for $200,000, but that house is valued at about $350,000, and Henry needs $30,000 to fix it up. So Henry actually needs $230,000, but the property that he's buying is going to be worth $300,000 to $320,000. So Nick needs $200,000 for his food truck business. Henry needs $230,000 for his real estate deal. Who do you think this local loan officer would rather lend the money to?
The local business.
Which one? The food truck or Henry's real estate deal?
The real estate deal.
Absolutely. Right. So we as real estate investors have an advantage because that local lender now has to take these two loans that they want to do, and they have to take them to a loan committee. And the loan committee has to decide if they're going to fund that loan or not. But if you are a local, if you're a lender, you've got to take deals, and you know you got to get approval at loan committee. You want to be taking deals into loan committee that your loan committee is going to want to fund, right? And so they're going to look at that deal and say, I can give Nick this $200,000, but we know based on history that, you know, restaurants typically fail within the first 5 years, right? And if it fails, then we can take back some of those assets, but I'm getting back a vehicle that's worth less than half of what it was worth the day it rolled off the lot. I'm getting back food equipment that we're going to try to sell for pennies on the dollar at some auction, right? And we won't recoup that $200,000 if Nick fails. If Henry fails, the bank takes back a property that's worth $300,000 to $320,000, but we've only had to give out about $200,000 to $220,000. And so they may actually be able to go ahead and sell that property even at a discount. If they sell that property even for $275,000, they still make money. They arguably make more money than they would make by me just making my loan payments over the course of the loan of that deal. And so it's a much lower risk investment for small community banks. And so as a real estate investor, if you understand those things, then you can develop these good relationships and you can get optimal lending and rates and terms and things as you establish more credibility and as you show them that you are doing what you say you're going to do, because they want to lend to you. You are bringing them deals that are safer for their bank.
Dude, that's such great info. So pivoting to all the great info that you're giving, you have a new book coming out. Talk a little bit about, this is your first book as far as I know, right? Published by BRRRR?
It's the first published book. Yes. Yeah. I have a book coming out. It's called Real Estate Dealmaker, and it is a guide to finding and funding real estate deals. So when you think about real estate, if you ask 10 investors, what's the biggest problem they're facing in the real estate investor business, especially if they're brand new investors. Five of them are going to say, I can't find deals to buy that make sense. The other five are going to say, I can't find the money to buy the deals that I want to buy, right? Like, that's just the way it works. It doesn't matter, man. I learned this when I first got started. When I was going to these real estate meetups, it didn't matter who I was talking to, whether they had hundreds of doors or no doors. They all would say, man, it's hard to find deals, right? Or, man, I need money for deals. And so I took that as an opportunity to figure out, if I can figure out how to solve these problems, well, then A, I know I have a room full of people who would love to buy deals, and B, I'll be able to grow and scale my business at whatever pace, right? So where do you typically buy deals, Nick? Like, what part of the country?
Usually Illinois, but nationwide for some stuff, but mostly Illinois lately.
Right. So if I called you tomorrow and I say, hey, Nick, I've got a landlord in Illinois. She's retiring. She's got five single family homes. They're in decent condition. There's tenants living in all of them. They're all paying rent. But she wants out of the business. She doesn't want to be a landlord anymore. She doesn't want to bother with putting her tenants out and then dressing these things up to sell them on the market. So she's going to sell them at a 40% discount from ARV. And I got a private money lender who loves lending in Illinois. And this lender is down to lend 95%. So all you'd need to bring is a 5% down payment. How many of these houses do you want to buy?
As many as you can bring me.
Right. You're going to buy every single one of them deals, right? Because you've got the deal flow is solved and the money flow is solved. And so I figured, if I can put together something that will teach people how to do that, how to solve for deal flow in your business, to help you figure out how to create a business that has leads coming in that you can then analyze and then make offers on, and then have money flow solved, meaning you figured out how to finance those deals in the way that best fits that deal in your financial situation, then people will grow and scale their business at whatever pace they're comfortable. I'm not saying they got to get 100 doors like me in 5 to 6 years, but if you don't have to worry about deal flow and money flow, you'll get to whatever your goals are at whatever pace you're comfortable getting there. And so that's what the book is about. It's a two-part book, essentially. The first half of the book teaches you all the ways that I've learned on and all the things that I do in order to find great deals. And then the second half of the book teaches you how to be a fundamentally sound real estate investor in terms of figuring out which funding fits the deal and that financial situation. Because what happens right now is a lot of people are learning maybe one or two ways to finance deals. And so they got their two hammers, right? They got their, I know how to do creative finance and I know how to do conventional loan lending. And so they're out there and they find deals and they're just hammering those deals with those two financing hammers. But those two financing hammers may not be the tool that's needed for the job. Creative finance is great. Like, owner finance is fantastic. Until you find a house that needs a $100,000 renovation, the owner ain't going to finance that $100,000. Now you got to go figure out where to get $100,000 to fix that property up. And now you don't have a house to secure that $100,000 loan against, right? And so it can be challenging. Maybe owner financing wasn't the best tool in the financing tool belt for that deal. And so you have to understand, what are all the ways I can finance a deal so that I can pick the financing that fits that deal the best and fits your financial situation the best?
Man, that's such great. The more tools you have in a tool belt, the more options you have to take a deal down and make money. So I feel like that's just a huge strategy for you guys. So where can people find it? How can they get it? When is it coming out?
Yep. The book, the best place to get the book is, you can go to www.biggerpockets.com/dealsbook. That's biggerpockets.com/dealsbook, DEALSBOOK. And you can pre-order the book right now. The book officially releases on June 11th. And so once the release date, you pre-order it now. So when the release date comes, the book will come straight to you.
That's fantastic, man. For anybody listening, all this will be in the show notes. I'm going to buy 10 and do a giveaway the week it comes out, just to support you, support the cause over there for sure. So make sure you're following the social media. So on top of that, now you also are teaching people, if they want more than just a book, they want to get a handheld, they want your resources, they want to work with you, the Closing Table and the Closing Table Mastermind. Is that a little bit about how people can do that?
Yeah, absolutely. We do. We teach people how to start to build and grow their real estate business. We teach them all about funding deals, but we teach them everything else they need to know to be a fundamentally sound real estate investor as well. We have a whole community of heart-driven real estate investors who are doing this not just because they want to make money, but because they want to use the wealth and the time freedom that they create to be of service to the people around them. So I'm pretty picky about who I choose to work with. We do an application process. We don't accept everybody who applies. I know a lot of people say stuff like that, but it's legitimate. We've turned people away. I only want to work with people who want to help other people. And so If that sounds like something you want to get my help from, then you can go to www.seeyouattheclosingtable.com, all spelled out. So that's SEEYOUAT, theclosingtable.com, and fill out the application. And yeah, then we'll get in touch with you. We'll hop on a call. We'll talk about it.
That's cool, man. I like, I think it was Mark Evans, one of the masterminds that I was in. Somebody said, what I pay for is for who's not in this group. So I feel like
yes.
that's kind of like what you said is like,
yes.
I got these free Facebook groups. It's like, yeah, go see what kind of help you get over there. Watch what happens there. So I think that's awesome, man. And of course, dude, your social media content's fantastic, man. So talk about how do people find you on social media? What are some of your best ways to connect?
Yeah, I give a lot of great free information away on social media. I've had people DM me all the time that says, hey, man, I haven't bought anything from you. I've just been consuming your free content and it's helped me buy XYZ units, man. So I do. I try to give away as much as I can there. So you can follow me on Instagram. I'm at the Henry Washington on Instagram. That's the best place to find me.
Awesome, man. So we have the book, we have the mastermind, we have the On the Markets podcast, and of course, we have the social media. All the different ways to join you at the closing table. You, sir, are somebody I've been watching and I've admired for a very long time. I appreciate you always being nice, coming up, giving me a hug and a smile, man. It's been a pleasure to watch you grow and to see you at some of these events and watch you just get on stage and share your experiences. And I'm really excited for the book. You bring your A game to everything you do in life. This interview has been no different. So you definitely brought your A game today. Any final thoughts before I let you go?
No, man, I appreciate you having me, guys. This is, you know, who you learn from is important. And I think people are learning from a good guy following you and listening to you. And so thank you for what you do for people and putting this information out there and being as helpful and kind as you are. I appreciate you.
I appreciate you, sir. Thank you very much. I like that the way you're leading is people first. I'm going to take that example and I'm going to try and be a little bit better today and be a little bit more like you, sir. So thank you so much for everything. Harry Washington, ladies and gentlemen, I'll see you at the closing table, sir.
Thank you, sir. See you at the closing table.